Boundary layer equations are difficult to solve, but in the case of laminar flow, an analytical solution can be found using a similarity solution. However, the following assumptions need to be made. In order to solve, we have to assume steady, incompressible flow. We also have to assume that the fluid properties are constant, as well as negligible viscous dissipation. And finally, we have to assume that dp dx equals zero. So with these assumptions, we can use the continuity, momentum, and energy equations to help solve these boundary layer equations. We'll start with continuity. Continuity says that du dx plus dv dy equals zero. The momentum equation says that u du dx plus v du dy equals the kinematic viscosity times d squared u dy squared. Finally, we have the energy equation. The energy equation states that u dt, where t is temperature, dx plus v dt dy equals alpha, which is the thermal diffusivity, d squared t dy squared. Take a look here at the similarities between these two equations. Basically, the only change we have is that it's T instead of U, as well as it's alpha, or the thermal diffusivity, instead of the kinematic viscosity. These can be simplified enough so that a similarity solution can be found. And by similarity, we mean that although the boundary layer will grow as we move down a flat plate, its velocity profile, u over u infinity, is going to stay geometrically similar. So we're going to solve these equations using the Blasius method, such that the velocity can be defined in terms of a stream function. So we define u as the derivative of the stream function with respect to y, and we define v similarly, except that it's negative and with respect to x. First, we check that continuity is satisfied. Du dx is just the second derivative of this stream function, dx dy. And we do the same thing for dv dy, and that's going to equal negative second derivative of this stream function, dy dx. And as you see, when you add the two together, you're going to end up with zero. The continuity equation is already satisfied. Now we can define new independent and dependent variables. Eta is defined as y times the square root of u infinity, which is the free stream velocity, divided by the kinematic viscosity times x. And our function of eta is going to be defined as this stream function divided by u infinity times the square root of the kinematic viscosity times x divided by u infinity. We can then figure out u and v through the stream function and the chain rule. So u, as we defined it before, which is using the chain rule, d phi d eta times d eta dy. And this is going to equal u infinity df d eta. And notice now, because f is only a function of eta, we can write it this way. We do the same thing for V, and we end up with an expression that looks like this. So let's solve for U together, and then you can try to solve for V yourself. So you notice I left the difficult one for you. Our stream function is this F times U infinity times the square root of the kinematic viscosity times x over u infinity. So when we take the derivative of that with respect to eta, we end up with u infinity times the square root of this kinematic viscosity times x divided by u infinity df d eta. If you recall, eta is equal to y times the square root of u infinity divided by this kinematic viscosity times x. So when we find d eta dy, this equals the square root of u infinity divided by the kinematic viscosity times x. So when we put these two together, multiply them together, what we end up with that u equals u infinity df d eta. Now we're going to find the derivatives. First, du dx is going to be the same as du d eta dx. If you recall, our u was just u infinity df d eta. Our du d eta ends up being u infinity d squared f d eta squared. Now we're going to find d eta dx. If you recall, eta is equal to y times the square root of u infinity divided by the kinematic viscosity times x. Our d eta dx is going to equal minus 1 over 2xy times the square root of u infinity divided by the kinematic viscosity times x. And hopefully you recognize this as eta. So our d eta dx is just minus 1 over 2x times eta. When we put these together, we have that du dx is minus u infinity over 2x times eta times d squared f d eta squared. We're going to do the same thing such that we find du dy, which ends up being u infinity times the square root of u infinity divided by this kinematic viscosity times x d squared f d eta squared. And finally, d squared u dy squared equals u infinity divided by the kinematic viscosity times x, all multiplied by d cubed f d eta cubed. And why do we need these? Well, we're going to use them in the momentum equation, and we put these into the momentum equation, and you can refer back to part one of this screencast to find what that is. We end up with a nonlinear third order differential equation. This can be solved with the suitable boundary conditions, and our conditions are that df d eta at eta equals 0 will equal 0, and df d eta at eta equals infinity equals 1. This differential equation can then be solved using a series expansion or analytically, and we end up producing the following solutions. These are known as the boundary layer solutions. They can be used to find a number of different variables. We can find del, which is the boundary layer thickness, as well as tau sub s, which is the shear stress at the wall. In subsequent screencasts, I'll show you how to find both of these properties.